conference where we are discussing the concept of equity in visual arts. This panel has the title Professionalism, Politicians, and the Third Parties. And it is dedicated to the topic of the relationship between the political and artistic realm, and particularly to the topic of active participation in decision-making process and in creating and influencing the cultural policies. We wanted to emphasize in this title that not only politicians should participate in the decision-making process, but also professionals and the third parties, such as civil societies, scholars, citizens, and all other concerned people who are interested in different issues. We will have today five panelists. I'm very glad that we have opportunity to hear Camille Crost, independent curator from United Kingdom, who will talk about a case study of democratic and participatory model of local governance in Glasgow. Then it will be with us Anne Battiston from Université Paris-1, Panthéon-Sorbonne, and Università di Venezia. In her paper, Between Occupation and Institutionalization, The Third Places, Real Estate, Speculation, Gentrification, or Autonomous Centers of Social Experience. She will ask questions like, can art react as a context of experimentation of new models of integration, mutualization, cooperation, and resistance? Third panelist is Mirjana Batinić, independent researcher from Croatia, who will discuss questions of collective work and self-organizations based on the interview with Croatian artists and art practitioners. Fourth panelist is Sheehan McIntyre from the University of Technology, Sydney, Australia. In her presentation, she addressed the question, how do the structures of power function in the artistic practice? How can the art making become an activist practice in order to challenge capitalist and colonial understanding of labor? And finally, Dragan Ćalović from the Faculty of Contemporary Arts from Serbia, who will examine the relationship between cultural political context and the perspective of the humanistic development of art and the beginning of the 21st century. So be welcome, be my guest, and I would like to ask Camila to start with her presentation.
Thank you very much. I will just share my screen and start with the presentation. Just a second.
Mm-hmm, we see.
Sorry. Yeah, can you see? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. And I'm very glad to be here and participating at the conference. My name is Camilla Crosta, and I'm a freelance producer based in Glasgow. And my practice is particularly focused on art and public spaces, as well as like art and the politics of food. I'm here to present today the case studies of the Glasgow Canal Cop And this is actually the result of the research project that I did as a final outcome of my master in cultural management at the University, the Queen Margaret University in Edinburgh. And I just want to analyze this model of cooperative that is a model of kind of participatory governance in the context of cultural and urban redevelopment of an area of Glasgow. The presentation, and during the presentation, just want to kind of introduce you to the research aims, some of the key questions that let me to undertake the research, the introduction of the cooperative, and in particular, I just want to kind of even open up to the role of the art organization, or what are the possibilities for the art organization in taking part to this model of governance. I will then outline very briefly some of the issues who came up during the research, and I will end with some final consideration. The what actually led me to undertake this research was the curiosity, and particularly I was curious and I'm still curious to kind of to try to understand how or if culture can be at the basis of a more democratic and inclusive decision making. To do so, so starting to look at the cross-sector collaboration with public and private partners, which predominantly are formed within the context of cultural planning. And this kind of collaboration actually seen quite positively in the literature because they seem to represent a potential for change and policy implementation. As in the diversity of its actor lies the opportunity to challenge the power structure of the elite in charge of the decision-making. On the other side, however, the effectiveness of this partnership is challenged by numerous problems, both internal and external of the partnership. And for example, like the understanding of the Xilos approaches that actually hinder the process of communication and collaboration. And I found quite interesting to look at the cooperative model, which based like on kind of cultural on cultural goals to how could actually improve this collaboration if they can, or also help in overcoming some of the issues that arise in the collaboration. And one last thing that led me to research these cooperatives, because I want to kind of understand if it's possible to do this model of governance, horizontal collaboration, is it possible to create new form of kind of relational and open and networked city? The Glasgow Canal Co-op is a young organization that has been established at the beginning of 2018 with the aims to improve and transform the canal area in the north of Glasgow into a vibrant neighborhood and creative and active place. The Co-op was born by the initiatives of its members, so it's not was not created for policy requirements. And is focused on the place rather than assets. The model is a cooperative model, which for its nature should help to regulate participation, giving opportunities to all the actors to express their voice during the process of decision making. Other interesting aspect of the cooperative is that there are quite a lot of number of cultural or creative organization between its members. And also what I found really interesting was both the model and the location have the potential to stimulate imagination and also hopes for creating a sort of unique and meaningful example of sustainable and inclusive development. So from one side is this potential of the cultural imaginary and also the democratic one, but at the same time as a kind of key to understand how improve and how to even research and promote these forms of horizontal collaboration. In the research, as I said, I would like was kind of paying a lot of attention to the role of the art organization because this model of collaboration that was before, but particularly now, are kind of they can represent opportunities to think and maybe develop alternative system of cultural production, and also attempting to build a fair and equal and more democratic cultural sector. They can also impact how artists and cultural organizations produce their work in the communities, bringing innovation and new opportunities. And here, I just want to kind of take you to very briefly to some of the issues that came up in the research, and hopefully we can discuss them together at the end of the presentation. The first issue is the issue of the participatory framework. So the cooperative framework is still and is well under process of development. There is a potential and kind of in this framework, but also for this to fulfill its potential, it's quite important to consider some of the key points. It is the first point is just needs to kind of understand why the members take part and the benefit they receive, what the benefits is intended both in monetary and non-monetary terms. There is a need to think also how this partnership works in terms of management and leadership and resources, particularly like the resources between the cooperative, the management of the cooperative and its member. And finally, another point to help like in reframe and developing this participatory framework, it's important to understand how to build a collective capacity, which is intended as how to put stakeholders together, stakeholders and resources together to act as a whole. And finally, that's the participatory framework. And then the second issue is the community inclusion. In the study also emerged the kind of difficulties to understand what and who is the community to engage, but also from the other side was the opportunity that the COP can offer the possibility to develop community ownership on the process of urban transformation. And this is a key point to go beyond beyond the consultation. But what is needed is to create more spaces and opportunities for the community to take part in the decision making. And the other two issues, one is the resources and trust. Resources, again, was a kind of key, a really important issue to talk about in this model of governance, because there is the need to rethink really what resources means and how they could manage it. Also, what and how we define the funding system. The cooperative could offer the opportunity. What emerged is that they could offer like alternative to the funding system and the projectification that is like the short-term project, but also this need to and be expanded and taken forward. And finally, the idea of trust development amongst members and the community, because trust was kind of considered essential in these forms of collaboration, but also because it's at the basis of knowledge sharing and collective capacity building. And it's important to identify how to best develop trust in order to create support in these times of insecurities. And those are the main issues with the merge. And I just want to finish with some final consideration. So as a result of the study, the cooperative and also these forms of horizontal collaboration could offer opportunities both for cultural organization, but not only, to learn, exchange, and challenge cultural assumption through collaboration, networking, and acting together. There could be a chance to rethink about inclusion and also community ownership. Well, I want to highlight some of the ideas and possibilities developed within these models, and hopefully we can discuss them together. The first one is the possibility that these models of governance can actually subvert the funding system. They can be open resource spaces for and with the community, and which is kind of based on this idea of resources and support that is not only in the monetary terms. there's the need also for this model to kind of understand and how to create a collective dimension, and in particular, how to include and integrate the process of co-creation and translation in order to include a different voice and perspective and also understand each other's. These forms of governance, the cooperative and other forms could also function as a mediator role to redefine the importance of exploring practice of engagement and ownership, but also they could offer spaces for experimentation and participation. And as a final point, I see that there's a lot of potential for these forms of governance, but also there is, I think, the real full realization can also happen beyond, like, in another system that goes beyond the neoliberal and capitalist system. So it's important to understand for this model of governance, which is their position and how they're acting towards the change of this system. And with this, it's all, and really hope to have more conversation with you about these issues.
Thank you, Camilla. We have enough time. Maybe we can share some comments or questions related to this issue. Do we have a question? Or comments or association? I was thinking about the slides. One of the last slides that you show us, and it seems to me as a kind of you see, this is like construction or of some kind of parastate system, as a parastate system of reality. And what do you think is this variable which could have a mediating role? Did you think about that further? What could it be, the variable with the mediating roles, Camille?
So for the kind of mediating role, this is a kind of like general idea that does even not apply only to the cooperative, but also these forms of kind of partnership and governance and even organization that they work into a network. And so they can just be function as a kind of mediating between institutions and communities, and more from like state level, national level, like decisions, and more from a local level. So kind of mediating between kind of the policy making, like mediating between all the more local and national level.
Mm-hmm.
Be more that kind of even spacey for representing ideas and even advocating for civil and cultural rights.
Mm-hmm. I understand. Mm-hmm. Do we have some more question or comments or thinking about this issue? Okay, maybe we will we could come back to this if we want, when we cross some impression from the other's presentation. We will have a time for the final discussion as well. So I would like to ask Anne Battiston to present her work. We will hear a bit more about the issue, how the art can be the place for the elaboration of new political strategies. How does art meet social and political needs? So,
yes. Thank you, and I'm very happy to take part of this conference and this debate. Yes, maybe I can ask a question to Camilla after, because I will talk about also the question of trust, but an especially one. So I will try to share my desktop. Okay. Huh? I'm trying to share it. Okay. 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 So I wanted to start this presentation with a contextualization of my purpose. I want to talk about the actual situation, so in the Western Europe context, and with the help of two case studies, the Wonderful Stand in Paris and the What to Say in Brussels.
Sorry, it seems that something's wrong. Maybe something's wrong with connection. Let's wait maybe a half of minutes, and if it does not work, maybe we can exchange some plan. Uh-huh. We don't see her. Mm-hmm. I would suggest maybe to leave Anne Battiston maybe for later, and try to, we will change something. Yeah, of course. Let's hear, if it is not a problem, presentation of Mirjana Batinić.
Okay. Problem.
And then we will come back to the presentation of Anne, if you agree.
Yes, from my side, perfect. So let me do the, hopefully I don't get stuck as well. Uh-huh. Just a second. Do you see my screen?
No.
No, not yet. Okay, so give me just a second, sorry.
I will just suggest maybe Anne to check your line and everything about presentation, and then we will come back to you soon.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, super.
So can I ask, it says that I am screen sharing.
We see it.
Okay, you see it. Okay. Okay, so the focus of this paper is on the principles and models of decentralized horizontal management in visual arts, on the example of four contemporary artists originating from Slovenia, Austria, and Croatia. What all artists have in common is that in addition to individual artistic activity, they are also very active in the field of cultural practices, which vary from creating, leading a gallery, art institutions, online television programs, teaching, etc. These are Vesna Bukovec, Evelyn Stermitz, Alexandra Gruden, and Nelly Ružić. I asked them two questions. So first is, what is your experience with the policies of participatory practice, collective work, and self-organization in other artistic fields and cultural practice? And the second is, in the context of rethinking the principles and models of decentralized horizontal management, individual arts, I'm interested in the impact of your cultural work on your independent artistic work as a different organizational model. And their answers were really well written, so I decided to simply read them instead of, I don't know, rechanging them with my own words. And in parallel, I will show examples from their individual artistic work. Okay, so first is Vesna Bukovec, multimedia artist from Ljubljana, Slovenia, explicitly political in her work and engaged predominantly in drawing, video, photography, and installation. Her cultural work is quite rich. It involves being a curator, program co-creator, the representative of the Open Chamber of Contemporary Art, a designer, and other for different organizations. These are Collectiva, a contemporary visual art group, Collectiva Institute, or in original in Slovenian, Zavod Collectiva, an NGO organization, then the Open Chamber of Contemporary Art, Odprta Zbornica, which is currently inactive, then Center for Contemporary Arts, STCA, Zavod za sodobnu umetnost, and finally the City of Women, Mesto Žensk, which is a pioneering organization focusing on feminism and gender equality in the arts and culture. So to start with something sweet, this is what Vesna wrote. So Collectiva is a contemporary visual art group established in 2002 between Metka Zupanić, Lada Cerar, and me. Its main characteristics are participation and collectivity, collective thinking and developing ideas, collective collection, collective curating and screenings, festivals and exhibitions. We were not active in the art market, which is anyway almost non-existent in Slovenia. We mainly produced video, photography and installation art, which were not suitable for the market, unlike paintings and prints, for instance. In 2008, we established the Collectiva Institute, which is an NGO, with an aim to apply for production funds. In a group, it's easier to develop an idea or a concept of the project. We have a chance to debate together, to confront different views, to get feedback, etc. I could say that we started a collective also to enable ourselves to work and act in public space, as this was difficult for young artists at the time. Okay, so she continues. I was also active in the Open Chamber of Contemporary Art, a self-organized group of artists who worked as an informal union of the self-employed artists. In Slovenia, due to the absence of the art market, practically all active creators are dependent on the fundings from the state or the city municipality and the status of self-employed in culture. So, as the representative of the Open Chamber, I served in two terms on the working group of the self-employed and the Ministry of the Culture. We discussed the problems of the self-employed and suggested solutions. So fortunately, almost nothing was taken into account, and I got the feeling that the operation of the group is just a formality with which the ministry gets an alibi to conduct a dialogue with the professional public. This was 10 years ago. And today, with an extreme right-wing government that is focused on the destruction of contemporary urban critical art, the situation is this act as well. The situation is disproportionately worse, essentially critical, and also to mention pandemic and the shutdown of cultural institutions. So, Vesna said that she was also working in the Center for Contemporary Arts and still is since 2006 as a designer, a co-creator of programs, culture curator and program collaborator of the physical and web archive of video art called DIVA. All these forms of operation are based on the co-work. My individual artistic practice is quite marked by the collaboration with the City of Women, or Mestozhensk in original, which is a pioneering organization focusing on feminism and gender equality in the arts and culture. This influenced my recent artwork, where collectivity is quite present visually. This refers to a series of drawings like Women Are Coming, which is this work. By name, it's a homage to the sculpture by Duba Sambolec, which is a tribute to the female cyclist protesters in Slovenia, which happen regularly. And it's a current rebellion, political rebellion against right-wing politics that unfortunately is happening for some time now in Slovenia. So my next artist is Evelyn Stermitz, artist and scholar living in Vienna, engaged mainly in photography, video art, and net art. Her focus is on gender-based female and social-cultural topics. Evelyn created the feminist net artwork called World as Female Avatars as an ongoing project of cyberfeminism. This is a project for expanded understanding of women and their relation to their own body. She established also ArtFem TV, a nonprofit online television programming presenting art and feminism. The idea is to promote the artistic works. Sorry. And projects of women artists on an international online video portal. The website features more than 500 videos dating back to early video art from 70s until current pieces from over 100 women artists, including Pipi Lotiris, Duba Sambolec, Guerrilla Girls, Marta Rosler, Marina Grzinic, Annie Abrahams, and many other women artists. So this is what Evelyn said. I collaborated on feminist art projects, for example, the Femlink video collages. I find it an interesting exchange of ideas and thoughts. A collaboration with women and feminist artists is an enriching and strengthening practice with kind of mutual understanding. ArtFem TV is a separate project, but it's a great source to see that many women artists are engaged in different feminist issues in the arts, whereby video art is a common practice. Performative video pieces are central for the expression of feminist ideas. The art market is only interested to sell work, whereby progressive and separate threads in the arts are overlooked. Okay. In art writing and progressive non-for-profit exhibitions, these works find recognition and can spur a discourse. Now, when it comes to ArtFem TV, Evelyn says that it never ever got funding. I'm funding the project on my own expenses. I have paid the website programmer, URL, and I have maintained the website since its beginnings. I have created and uploaded all images and videos on my own without any payment or funding for the time and engagement in the project. Only the server or host of the website is for free from an artist-run organization in Graz, and that is mur.at. This organization supports artistic online projects, which is very important because the website with its video data content demands a lot of server space, and this is usually very expensive to pay at the free market. Okay, so with ArtFem TV, I aim to make visible the importance of international women's feminist video art. And feminist video art is also a major aspect of my own artistic work. Next artist is Aleksandra Saška Gruden. She is based in Ljubljana and Maribor, Slovenia. She's a multidisciplinary artist engaged mainly in performance, installations, video, and sculpture. Her artwork is pretty much engaged in a public space. So When it comes to Sashka, her experience in cultural practices involves being a curator, a producer, a program manager, a journalist, a set designer, art teacher, and so on. So this is what Sashka wrote. Participatory practices offered me opportunities for dynamic involvement and collaboration. This was shown in organizing the International Festival of Computer Arts, MFRU, where I was creating and producing the mobile presentations model. The financial structure was solid and supported by the institution within which the festival was held, which is MKC Maribor, a multimedia cultural center Maribor. So I cooperated with other artists in performances or art projects within the association too, or in original Društvo too. We shared ideological, aesthetic, political, economic, or technological views. We obtained funds through tenders and worked to revive abandoned premises. I mostly work in a self-organizing form in a non-institutionalized field, which allows me to some extent to work independently. Otherwise, I try to obtain funds through various tenders and calls. I succeeded in this for a maximum of two projects per year. I also try to present the projects I prepare with an individual gallery or other institution that partially cover production costs, of course, in Slovenia. production, I mean, in Sashka's case, not only in Slovenia and abroad, production and creating contributed to gaining new skills that I introduced in my own work. One such good practice was raising funds. Now, since Slovenian art market is very small, it is necessary that the institutions and individuals present themselves in the international space. An exhibition in a gallery or an installation in a public space alone does not offer a sufficient presentation and does not cover enough wide circle of interested public. And finally, Nelly Ružić. So Nelly is a multidisciplinary artist based in Split, Croatia, with a long experience of living in Mexico City. She uses different media such as film, photography, objects, installations, and video installations, and often does procedural work over long periods of time. Okay, so Nelly has also very rich cultural practice, which involves being a curator, program creator, leader of a gallery, art teacher at School of Fine Arts in Split and art academies UMAS in Split, Croatia, then NPEG La Esmeralda in Mexico City and UAM Cuernavaca in Mexico, Universidad Autónoma de Estado de Morelos. So this is what Nelly wrote. From the very beginning, my artistic practice was intertwined with cultural and pedagogical work. One of the first such experiences was GAP, Gripe Art Project, from 1995 to 1997, which was formed by Toni Horvatić, Rino Efendić, and me in Split, Croatia. GAP was one of the first nonprofit associations dealing with contemporary art in the post-war period. It had smaller support from the STCA Zagreb, but mostly we financed and did everything ourselves. Okay, at the time we organized a series of exhibitions, including some of the authors of Gorgona, among others, Ivan Kožarić. So after moving to Mexico, I organized a series of exhibitions in collaboration with students. The experience of the Transitos project, a transdisciplinary seminar and workshop organized by the Centro Nacional de las Artes, I really hope Nelly's not listening to this because I don't really speak Spanish at all, in which I was a participant for several years, was crucial. Diplomado Transit was a kind of experimental transdisciplinary upgrade of graduate students. The participants of these workshops were final year students or professionals in various artistic and non-artistic fields. Okay. So if I were to single out the most interesting project, perhaps it is Emerging House, Casa Emergente, that I found together with students in 2006 during a strike at UAM, Cuernavaca in Mexico, in a house we got for use. I curated its first exhibitions and I was a mentor of that independent and profitable space. Later, after returning to Split, I worked with Viktor Popovich on the project Do It, organized by the Art Gallery in Split 2016, with students of School of Fine Arts and Art Academy in Split. So an interesting experience was the conception and coordination of Infinitivi, a collaborative project and exhibition with art students from Mexico City and Split. I was the first gallery manager in Galeria Škola, the school gallery in Split, Croatia. As a special feature of this gallery, I defined the creation of links and spaces of dialogue between contemporary art practices and innovative approaches in art education. Within the program for the next 3 years, some of the most important authors of the contemporary art scene were present, with equally important accompanying programs such as workshops and talks with artists, theoretical thematic lectures, screenings and exhibitions of school projects and student works. As for curatorial work, I need to mention Almisa Open Art Festival in Omish, Croatia, 2020. Theme was Emergency, Hitnost. And funny enough, she made this theme before Corona happened, I think a year before she applied with the theme of Emergency. Through interventions, actions, performances, projections, and other hybrid forms, artists address the audience, random passersby of the town of the town Omish. In the time of emergency, it seems even more important, as Rancière says, to raise the question of the relationship of aesthetics and politics to the level of sensory demarcation of what is common to community, the form of its visibility and organization. In the time when emergency overrides contemporaneity, maybe it is possible to anticipate a new weaving community. And that's it, thank you. And thanks to the authors.
Thank you. Maybe you can close the shared screen.
Okay.
And we can see, do we have any question or comments? I was wondering, Mirjana, did you recognize some similarity or some intriguing question for you for next research? Which would be your issue according to their statement? Because I tried to map that social construct that is between lines when they are making this statement. But what do you think? What is the most intriguing things in their statements?
Well, they are all very active also as human beings, as to better world, to make this world a better place. Also, when it comes to being a woman, you're a minority just because of being a woman. And I have a big interest to move towards myself in that direction. Mm-hmm. So more political activism and also migration and et cetera.
Mm-hmm. This is just a comment. It seems to me that somehow they have something similar in their very high level of dedication and kind of self-investment, but only also at the economic plan, not just emotional investment or creative investment, but it seems to me that they participate also at the economic level. So to enable material conditions for the practice of commoning, maybe it seems to me.
When I posed these two questions, I had like sub questions, and one of them was to elaborate the economical situation, because artists constantly struggle. These are all highly educated women who, you know, struggle with getting finance to make their work. Not only them, all of art world. So that's a big pity, and art, even you know, like it's never really evaluated enough. And now with Corona, many schools in many countries are just putting art education outside. Like, it's not important. We don't need it. We need economy. We need maths. You know, money make world go round. But yes, so it's quite critical. And also, it's interesting in the first case, in case of Vesna Bukovets, when she wrote me this, and she wrote that the political situation in Slovenia is quite critical. And every day, something after she wrote this, which was a few days ago, or a few weeks ago, after every day was, you know, worse and worse. And people would be like, if you are critical, what she mentioned there is like, you are, as an artist, you are in Slovenia, you're dependent on the country to pay you, sort of the contribution in social and health care and retirement, which is the minimum anyway. But now they deleted a person because he's critical. So it's a musician, and he's, I think he's a rapper. So he has quite a tongue, we would say, in our languages. So it's a very, you know, like, he's not good for this right-wing country, right-wing politics at the moment. So, you know, you don't spit on us, or we will not, you know, you won't be financed by us. So this is very important. The freedom is hopefully not in the past, but it's not in a good situation at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mirjana. Thank you very much. I would ask Anna maybe to come back to your presentation, and I think it is now maybe a better situation with connection.
Yeah, sorry for these technical problems. Well, I think it's better now.
Beauty of informational technology.
Exactly. yes, so I reshare my screen.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Okay, we see.
Okay, perfect. So I wanted to start with a consideration. As a result, or better, in accordance to with the actual neoliberal hegemony in all the life aspects, so politic, not so not only political, economical, but also in the field of culture, the process of artistic production, as well as the access to the art, to the artistic product, is mainly now governed by capitalistic principles. After this consideration, I wanted to analyze a particular aspect of this actual context, actual situations, which is, yes, political, economic, and social. So I want to analyze the instrumentalization of real estate market of places of art which we can call independent, alternative, third places in a more generical concept. So the image you can see here is the opening of an exhibition of a collective named Jeune Création in Paris, in a particular site on the suburbs of Paris, Romainville. And the opening was on 2019, so is very contemporary. And the estate of the real estate of Fiminko, that you can see, is on the origin of the project. The project is a big corner of galleries and not only commercial galleries, but especially third places. We will see after, in particular, what are these third places. For the exhibition of these gallery of Jeune Création, artists were made activism and react to this situation, and they they refused to take part of the exhibitions, as you can see here, and start a political action to make people of the contemporary art world aware of what was the reality behind these structures in Romanville. As I said before, I want to talk about this question taking two study cases. The first one is the collective wonder in Paris. And I wanted to show you this collective by an artwork, a production, which is in progress, named Mausolée Quad-Core, of one of the artists or one of the founders of the collective, Pierre Gagnard. So it's a 3D screen, 3D scan of one of the buildings of this collective, which is Nomad. So you can see here the aesthetics of this project is very linked into the aesthetic of different practice of the artists of the collective. About the second one, the second case of studies, I want to talk about this product, this film, the case is the WTC, the World Trade Center in Brussels, and the collective of artists is not organized one like the first one, but mostly just a group of artists which decide to share spaces, resources, not only physical but also intellectual, the film is realized in 2020 and is directed by two of the artists of this collective at WTC, Liette Bowens and Wouter De Rive, who decided to take part in the political and social issue of the towers of the World Trade Center in Brussels. They worked on the 25th floor and which was the floor of one of the towers. We have to know that it was a very big modern urbanistic project, and we started in the 1970 and then fold, and the towers were abandoned, and this is where the artist came, and after some years, in 2013, the artist arrived in the building. In 2017, the owner of the building, of these two buildings, decided to retake the building and restart the project. So the architect, the owner, and other actors of this kind of urbanistic situations, which is a typical in the West Europe, take part. So the artists decided to they choose some actors, the political and social actors of these urbanistic situations, and they made like a critical mirror. So here we can see these are the actors, and these are the real actors of the urbanistic project, and the real one were looking at the fictions one. I just want to present the organization of these two cases, these two places. So this is the first one, The Wonder in Paris, and is a very typical strategies for alternative places in Paris. This artisan space, so is a place managed by and for the artists, take part of a system, an urbanistic system, which we call transitional urbanism, which is the occupation of abandoned building, thanks to a contract stipulated with the owners for a limited temporality, so the wonder was firstly on the suburbs. It takes place on different suburbs of Paris: Saint-Ouen, the beginning, Bagnolet. Bagnolet, Nanterre, and now he is in Clichy. So I show these photos to show you the aesthetics of the project. Even if I don't want to analyze the question by the aesthetics, but mostly by the organization of the places of art. So the places where the art is produced and where the art meet the public. So is every time is a very big space which can in which they organize a lot of public events in a transdisciplinary point of view, so artistic events, but also this kind of urban operas, ritual performances, and other kind of action in the urbanic context. Yes, the group of artists in Brussels is quite different. So firstly, because it's not an organized collective which share the same, not the same, but share an aesthetics, a kind of aesthetics, which is, as you can see, for the Wonder Collective, very linked to the underground aesthetics and the suburbs aesthetics. So this is the first important difference. As I said, the towers of this World Trade Center are emblematic of this modernist utopia, which is still called a Manhattan Plan. It was conceived in 1960, as I said, an important thing, it was in the north quarter of Brussels, the Quartier Nord, which is a very specific neighborhood in a political and social point of view, because it is one of the most important class crossroads of the immigration of migrants in the region of Brussels. And this is historically. To carry out this program, to this project of modernist utopia, a large part of the population of this Quartier Nord was expelled, ejected. And then when the project failed, the towers was completely empty. Three were built of four, which was on the project. It is in a group of artists which occupied another space in the center of Brussels, and the key personality of the group was the artist Alina Knipkens, a filmmaker, which for chance, completely for chance, started to take a film in the towers, and there she can start a relation with the owner and ask for this convention of temporary occupation. There was 40 people, and they wanted to work in collectives, to mutualize resources as a response of the individualistic and also competitive contemporary art system. So it was not a place for, this is two photos of the atelier. This is was the sharing workplace, and this is was so even if the project was not open to public events, and here after the occupation of the artists, all their actors started to come to the towers. So this is because the owner started to understand that to have artists in on the place, it was better to not have, and that artists attracted a particular kind of population, which was good because the population of the Cartenard was not the good population to attract investors for their new urbanistic project. So a school of architecture take place on another floor of the building, and this is the final exhibition of the School of Architectures. Another collective, which is a collective of designers, creators, architects, created by the owner, take place in one of the other floor, and take part, an important part, to the organization of the public events. So the collective of artists on the 50 floors was there just for work. They just share the place of work, and the other public events was organized by Up for North, which was the collective created by the owners to put on the project this kind of aesthetic of engagement, because this collective Lab North was engaged on projects like ecological project, cultural project linked with, in a relation with the territory, which was a fake relation with the territory. It was just a marketing.
Sorry, Anne. Go to the conclusion, because we will not have a time for all participants. Can we go from the conclusion?
Yes. So I just want to show you, these are the two buildings in Paris. This is the new one. These are the towers of the Quartier Nord. And this is the Quartier Nord after the end of the at the moment in which the owner wanted decided to retake the towers. And we can see, so this is the Maximilian Park. And it was a very important camping of migrants, and we can see the sign of the camping here. Mm-hmm. Yes, and has an answer to these two problems. So the social inclusions and the lack of the temporality of this kind of project, which are just for some month of or some years, the two collective decide for two different strategies. The first one of the wonder is to create a relation with the estate Novaxia, take the building and give the building for free for the collective. The Brussels collective decide to open this project named Permanent. And the Permanent is use exactly the trust, the community land trust, to create a collective owner in which the artists take part. And this is a kind of social way to acquire the territory in which not only the artists can take place, but also people with the poorest part of the population. So the question I want to open to this debate is how we can make hospitality for people we are considered out of place, and how we can resolve this problem on temporality, and if the political autonomy place of art is possible. Thank you.
Thank you. These are quite intriguing question. I would ask you just to stop sharing screen.
Yes.
To see each other a bit more. Anna, thank you. Do we have maybe some questions, or we can go forward and then keep some time for the end if we want to discuss something more? If there is no question, I would ask Sean McIntyre from the University of Technology, Sydney, to share with us how can the art making become an activist practice challenging capitalist understanding of labor.
Thank you. I'll share my screen and try and keep it tight because I know we're meant to be finishing. Okay. So, hi, thank you everybody. It's super interesting. I'm really looking forward to, hopefully if we've got time, chatting all together, because there's been some really exciting and parallel conversations happening so far. So thank you for inviting me, and thanks for everybody so far. I'm really excited. This is the title. I'm Sean McIntyre. I'm a freelance artist and curator and current PhD candidate at the University of Technology, Sydney, and I'm based in Glasgow. So first up, I will cover some of the terms that I'm using and what I mean by them. The artists that I'm mostly discussing here are those who dedicate themselves to a full-time art practice that is not their sole source of income. I'm using practice and process, etc., to describe the processes that occur toward the development of an artwork: the research, empty space, conversation, wasted time, seemingly unrelated activities that consciously contribute to developing an artwork. When I'm talking about art product, etc., I'm referring to the resulting artwork that emerges from practice and process, often displayed in a gallery or other formal public space away from the artist's studio. Value, that's the social, political, and economic value, both the measurable and unmeasurable, that an artistic practice generates. I have found that we in the art world really lack the language to communicate the complexity and messiness of an artistic process. For this reason, I'm borrowing from anthropologist Anna Singh and her writings about forest, plantation, and resurgence to try to find windows to discuss the active doing, that is, living, making, and thriving outside economical systems. I'm using Anna Singh's discussions of forest and resurgence as a framework for considering forest as a collaborative, diverse, ever-growing and changing, vibrant and thriving multi-layered environment. Anna Singh describes plantations as killing off beings that are not recognized as assets. Her description of plantation is perhaps useful to consider the ways that we extract only the product of artistic labor and artwork, while failing to recognize the value and context of production. I want to footnote here that while I'm talking specifically about artistic value, I acknowledge that there are many other spaces where work is not financially remunerated and that where people are fighting for recognition of labor and expertise in current colonial, capitalist and patriarchal systems. So I made this graph at the beginning of my PhD. It illustrated the frustration I was feeling about the arts at the time. Prior to a PhD, I did an honors of fine arts. I co-directed an artist-run space voluntarily. I did a master's of fine arts and then directed a not-for-profit gallery on a university campus, which was a paid position. I started my PhD because, like many of you, I have some concerns about issues of accessibility, sustainability, class, and opportunity in the arts. The lack of funding, lack of relevance, and lack of representation felt like a vicious circle and one that we are continually struggling to break free of. My initial response to these issues was to try and find ways to pay artists, to maybe bring them into a commercial sector, to monetize the skills that they have developed through their practice. But I realized swiftly that this approach is actually parallel to the ideas that I was trying to question, and it fails to recognize the value that is embedded within the artistic process, turning the doing into another asset that can be bought and sold. I'm interested in these issues for personal reasons also. As a cis white woman who has been able to study the arts, I am one of the people on this graph who has had their ideas disproportionately amplified in the current system. I am also someone who left my art practice because I realized it was not financially viable for me. In a recent Eflux podcast, discussing his latest book, One Number is Worth One Word, Lewis Kamnitzer stated, "We should only be producing art when everyone in society has a possibility of doing so and not before." I stopped making art in 2014 when I started facilitating the creative practice of others through my role at Verge Gallery. Although I established artist fees and focused on providing platforms for voices that were underrepresented, I came to question why, in an art gallery, a space that was dedicated to showing art made by artists, I was the one on a full-time wage, while our small artist fee only really compensated artists for the time spent organizing and installing their actual exhibition. How can we ensure that everyone in society has a possibility of making art when the reality of pursuing an artistic practice is accepting that you may never be sufficiently financially remunerated for your labor? So what we know. We know that artistic practice, if not immediately recognizable as generating a valuable commodity, is considered to be indulgent, optional, and unessential, as stated in this poll from the Singapore Sunday Times. We know that artistic practice, if not centered on the making of a marketable product or skill, is not sustainable. Ads like this one, encouraging artists to retrain, illustrate this mentality. If you can't make a living for it, it's not a problem with the system. You're just not good enough and you should do something else. We also know that these systems mean that those who are not from financially privileged backgrounds are often underrepresented within the art sector. We know that the art market uses artworks to demonstrate wealth and success, positioning artworks as luxury rather than integral to functional society. We know that artwork outside this sphere, so non-commercial work, activist art, and socially engaged art, is often considered valuable only if it achieves an outcome or reaches a certain audience, which is often determined by the art world rather than the groups that the artwork is trying to engage with. We understand that the current systems of value rely on art product rather than valuing the process of making it. The wasted time, thinking time, dead time, generative time, conversations, interactions, walks, and seemingly unrelated activities that contribute to forming a work of art. In trying to communicate the doing and other complicated systems of art making and distribution, I found myself generating graphs like this. They felt like the best way to communicate the dead ends, wasted time, or procrastination that an artistic practice allows, and how these might open space up, might open up opportunity for alternative outcomes, the establishment of an artist-run space, participating in community events, or developing skills in a new medium. How do we communicate all of this and what it offers to society? We don't have a clear language for talking about time or work that is without outcome. In a recent residency at Scottish Sculpture Workshop, I attempted to interpret my diagrams using hooks, found, cast from bronze, made from ceramic, and forged. They form a set of tools that might be used in a conversation about process. The making of the tools is a process in itself. The melting of one material to create a new form, the way that the object shifts and changes and the balance shifts when connected with another are all ways that this process and shift could maybe be communicated. So often when I'm talking about process, I find myself using environmental analogies, the old growth budding new flowers, the seemingly insignificant and microscopic pores reproducing and traveling, spreading and developing in ways that the naked eye might completely overlook. The impact that capitalism has on nature is similar to the impact that capitalism has on an artistic process, pushing away all the elements that don't have an immediate marketable value and focusing on extraction, investment, and capital. Thinking about the arts in terms of ecology is not revolutionary. Numerous papers, reports, and articles titled Cultural Ecology, Arts Ecologies, Ecology in the Arts. Often when we talk about ecology in this capacity, it is inclusive of venues or theaters that display an art product. It's inclusive of the studios that house artistic practice, the government that funds the markets and commercial sectors that feed from creative practice. In this way, the studio becomes a factory. The artist becomes worker, while the audience, gallery, curator, commercial sectors are all consumers. This system or approach might work if artists were getting paid for their hours of work, but we know that this is rarely the case. This map is by artist Emily Speed and was AN's contribution to the Art Party in Scarborough, which was a festival supporting the arts that took place in 2013. So perhaps the current art ecology looks like this. The artwork is a package that leaves the artist's studio and holds potential for investors to see profit or reportable results. One artwork provides an opportunity for an investor to get a tax break. A successful social outreach project means that developers might begin to gentrify a previously undesirable area. A blockbuster light installation might bring people into a city during tourist off-peak. The art product is currently the only outcome of artistic labor that has the potential to contribute towards financial recognition of artistic process. Yet, this single vessel rarely provides enough nourishment, financial or otherwise, to sustain the complex root systems that feed it. As a plantation is capitalism's tool to render nature profitable, the art market is capitalism's tool to make the artistic process profitable. The art market takes complicated, messy, open-ended, collaborative, and embedded process of making work and requires the artist to extract value in the form of an art product or artwork. Anna Singh states, plantations discipline organisms and resources as resources by removing them from their life worlds. Investors simplify ecologies to standardize their products and to maximize the speed and efficiency of replication. The machine of the art market isn't the only arena that requires the removal of art from its life world. Grants, exhibitions, social engagement projects, bursaries, etc., all require the artist to untangle their practice, present neat, tidy products, and formulate rationales for their value, often in competition with other artists. Yet, artists form their own ecologies. In response to COVID-19 and insufficient and unfair funding, artist groups like Keep It Complex formed solidarity syndicates, undermining the lottery nature of funding with groups of artists pooling and sharing funds to work towards fairer, more evenly distributed funding. Melbourne group AFIDS redistributed their government and private sector funding to launch a no competition art prize, asking Victorian feminist artists to submit their names. 10 were drawn out of a hat and given $1,000 each. Their website states, "This is an imperfect gesture, but we believe collective, generous, and inclusive actions are important strategies for making art and culture. Artists need space and resources to work towards new ideas and future, and we are aware that our community has been working beyond capacity in 2020. Anna Singh calls this resurgence. Resurgence is a work of many organisms negotiating across differences to forge assemblies of multi-species livability in the midst of disturbance. Singh also talks about how this natural resurgence is hugely important to humans and has the potential to form intimate relationships between forest and farmer. So If the artistic process is forest, artistic product, or the way that we attach value to the artistic product is a plantation, and the conscious subverting, rebuilding, forming, and collaborating that artists do to support their communities is resurgence, what can this offer us when we're imagining another art world? Perhaps like a farmer coexisting with a forest, there is potential for artist mechanisms to coexist with artists, to respect the work that is embedded in artists simply being, simply living and growing without requiring a profitable outcome from this labor. The act of doing, regardless of output and despite current conditions, is in itself an act of resistance. Writer Claire LeBurge describes in her book, Wages Against Artwork, that artists subvert capitalist understandings of labor, profit, and commodity by removing their labor from market-based circulation, mostly due to the fact that art works very rarely actually sell. Artists are actively building alternative economic measurements of achievement for society and are also generating alternative economic systems. As Australian poet and playwright Alison Croghan, who's quoted here, describes, by maintaining their practice despite continual cuts and even blatant dismissal from governments, artists are offering alternative systems to the art world and to the world in general. So COVID-19 has meant that the systems that determine the value of art practice, like galleries, have been unavailable to artists. In response, artists have generated their own ways of distributing art and supporting artistic labor. In conversation with an artist that I had recently, they reflected about how COVID-19 actually freed up space for them to make, as they weren't distracted by administration, emails to galleries, grant applications, and having to work a money job to survive. They were given emergency relief funding from the city, as they were described as self-employed thanks to many years of working as a barista, as a sole trader. So another art world might be one where we leave room for the flexibility, the messiness and entanglements, and allow artists to generate and share without the need to focus on one consumable product. Another art world might be a space where artists can be, as Lewis Kmitza describes, flexible citizens that constantly maintain critical distance from which they can improve society. He argues that this is better than the definition of artist as producer of objects, of tangible things that can be traded. So that with or without the systems that dictate whether or not artistic labor is a success or has value, artists are still doing. They are making art, they are making community, they are making space and imagining possible new futures by forming complex relationships and adapting to hostile environments. Perhaps we look to the doing as a space of inherent value rather than consistently turning to capitalist measures of productivity and consumption. So before we look to invest in the systems that dismantle, speculate, and profit from artistic labor, we maybe need to start investing in artistic process to provide the space to artists to get on with the doing and to see what new world might be created. That's me.
Thank you very much. These maps are very suggestive and adorable, really. Do we have any question or comments? Okay, maybe we will have some time on the end. I would like to ask maybe Dragan Ćavović to share with us your thoughts about humanistic development at the beginning of 21st century.
Okay, thank you. Hello to everyone. I'm not sure my screen because I have actually no presentation, but maybe a little bit later, maybe I can share some short footage with you. So to better understand the perspectives of humanistic development, we should reflect on Freire's thought. As he said, true liberation as the great humanistic task has as its condition education for understanding of oppressive society. Only through such education, oppressed can recognize their tendency to become oppressors, which is specific for initial stage of every social struggle as essentially wrong. becoming oppressors, former oppressed, actually re-establish old conditions, even though the roles are changed. This is why the revolution that is focused on redistribution of power, but that keeps old interpretation of society, is historically meaningless. Revolution by which society can be truly reshaped is conditioned by very different structure of thought that leads those who entered the struggle. Paulo Freire explored the role of experiential liberating education as a preparation for cultural revolution. Cultural revolution takes the total society to be reconstructed, including all human activities, as the object of its remolding action. Society cannot be reconstructed in a mechanistic fashion. The culture, which is culturally recreated through revolution, is the fundamental instrument for this reconstruction. So, cultural revolution is the revolutionary regime's maximum effort at conscienza. It should reach everyone regardless of their personal path. He emphasizes that both humanization and dehumanization are possibility for a person, but only the first is the people's vocation. The struggle for humanization should affect not only those whose humanity has been stolen, but also those who have stolen it. So we can imagine an inclusive negotiation that will not change relation between center and margin, but that will erase any distinction between them. This inclusive negotiation must be historically radical in Freire's understanding of radicalism and in connection with his thoughts that sooner or later, being less human, leads the oppressed to struggle against those who made them so. In order for this struggle to have meaning, the oppressed must not, in seeking to regain their humanity, which is a way to create it, become in turn oppressors of the oppressors, but rather restores of the humanity of both. So my question here is, can we recognize art, or more specifically, certain artistic approaches as a powerful force able not only to deconstruct mechanisms of oppression and to show that the dehumanization is not a given destiny, but the result of an unjust order, but also to create new visions of struggle and to initiate radical historical changes? I strongly believe that we can, which is why we should direct our theoretical approaches in a way that supports humanistic development of art. And let's see, as an example, the approach of Alexei Shulgin, who used irony to question the dehumanization of modern society. Alexei Shulgin is a Russian-born artist who uses a humorous approach to organize semi-spectacle events. Through his work, he questions patterns that shape contemporary performative practice. He's one of the net art pioneers and also the co-founder of the Moscow WWW Art Center, which is, according to artist statement, a website devoted to the highest possible level of art life uncertainty. In his early projects, we can recognize the pop art sensibility that emerged fully in his work 386DX, probably led by this sensibility, Shulgin in his work inverts mainstream culture to emphasize alienation of contemporary performative practice. The 386DX is an artistic project in which he manipulates an antiquated computer to perform digital renditions of popular music hits. On his website, Shulgin described this project as the world's first cyberpunk rock band. Yet his band excludes other performers, instead of whom Shulgin appears on the stage carrying one computer supplied with an Intel 386DX processor running text-to-speech and musical instrument-to-digital interface software. In his rockstar-like appearance, Shulgin changes an electric guitar to the computer keyboard that he wields on during his performing on synthesized versions of familiar pop songs such as California Dreaming by Mamas and Papas or Nirvana's grunge hit Smells Like Teen Spirit. Even though he performs a concert-like spectacle, his versions of these popular songs sounds like a mixture of Robert singing and early video game soundtracks. Shulgin performed his concert in a variety of places. He took a part in a different exhibitions and events such as Le Musée d'Art Moderne in Paris, Royal College of Art London, California Institute of Art Los Angeles, Jutland Academy of Fine Arts, Aarhus, Denmark, etc. Among these, he also organized the 386DX concert at the San Diego-Tijuana border at December 18, 1999. Shulgin was invited to present his work at Tijuana Media Center. Due to complicating the immigration bureaucracy and strict visa regulations, Shulgin split his band between border lines. While he was placed in the USA, the Border Fields State Park, his computer was transferred to Mexico at Las Paz de Tijuana. The public from both sides was called to witness the start of a new era in which computers are replacing humans at all levels, with or without borders. Placed on two sides of the border, events symbolically untied public form, US and Mexican side, but at the same time emphasized the whole political apparatus that separates two sides. The event turns to simulated spectacle, questioning the relationship between public and their understanding of regulation that linked them to a specific country. The work is also presented without Shulgin as a computer solo concert replacing the street musicians. A computer was placed at different locations, Arbat Street, Moscow, Street of Graz, Austria, Street of Malmö, Sweden, while passerby were provoked to leave monetary tips. In 2000, Shulgin published 386DX The Best Of as an unchanged CD. Besides the compilation of 15 popular songs, the disc includes the software he used to produce tunes from his repertoire, as well as a bootleg copy of Windows 3.1, the operating system the software runs on. On his official presentation, Shulgin invites public not only to listen to the tunes, but also to reconstruct the 386DX on their computers by booting it from the CD. During the 20th century, engaged art was focused to activate audience to turn the public from a passive spectatorial position. Art was seen in direct opposition to what Boris Groys called the passivity of the masses paralyzed by the spectacle of modern life. Social engagement in art was led by a desire to emancipate the public from a state of alienation induced by dominant ideology. Beginning from this premise, especially participatory art, as Bishop noticed, has taken a task to restore and realize a communal collective space of shared social engagement. Tendencies like these had different outcomes. Futurists celebrated war as a collective catharsis. Constructivists, on the other hand, gave their support to Bolshevik society, while Parisian Dadaists experimented with a more nihilistic approach. In the post-war period, a new range of artistically engaged strategies have appeared, mostly tied to leftist politics. But during the 1970s, everything was about to change, as Bishop noticed, from an agitatorial force campaigning for social justice. The community arts movement became a harmless branch of the welfare state. And so we find ourselves faced today with different artistic practices that are engaged, but that necessarily do not criticize dominant ideology. This doesn't mean that these works of art do not bring any changes, but their critic is not a part of some modernist-like revolutionary movement for a new society. And especially in digital art, where participation of public is more a matter of fully used medium potentials than a result of alternative approaches that oppose to conventional taste. Even though we are facing with different challenges, contemporary art still stays on a line of social engagement, questioning our relations to a humanistic vision. Understanding of oppressive society requires understanding of mechanisms of its reproduction. It requires an effort to recognize the reality of oppression as a historical fact, but not as a historical necessity. Only new cultural space can provide the new knowledge. What we mean when we say new knowledge are not the new results of scientific researches, but knowledge that grows on radically new paradigms. That kind of new knowledge can be accomplished not through a new system of values, but also through new cultural space, which is actually crucial for a process of overcoming all prejudices of old society. For that, we need art development in a humanistic key. Art that we need should provide new visions that can inspire both oppressed and oppressors to come together in a process of reconstruction of our society. What we propose here are radical social changes through reconstruction of cultural space, different system of values, different aspirations, and different horizons for future development can arise only under different cultural context. And our duty is to build that context, actually. So maybe if we have a few more minutes, I will be glad to share with you one footage, if it is okay, just to... sorry, I can't hear you.
I was thinking that maybe it's better to leave some time, few minutes, okay, for discussion to share some questions, and then,
okay, then
maybe we can continue to follow the footage for all who has time more. But I wanted to use...
Okay.
3-4 minutes maybe for sharing or for impression or questions.
Okay, thank you then. I will mute myself.
Don't mute, maybe we will discuss now. If you have any question for Dragan, be free to pose this question. I see that we have one question for Sian. Sian, how will the trend you describe, how do you think that this trend can continue after COVID?
Oh, yes, it's actually very...
Dragana, sorry, it is, this is a question for Cian, but you can...
Sorry, I understood you that Cian asked that question. Sorry, then.
This was a question for Cian, I think related to one of the map that she offered us, but also it is relevant for your question, so you can maybe add your part. Cian, can you hear you first? Can we hear?
Yeah, I guess I probably wouldn't call it a trend. I guess it's sort of the idea that artists are working and focusing on their process and supporting each other in making work and creating systems that can support that sit outside the dominant systems has always been happening. But I guess from COVID, because those dominant systems, because the normal spaces that we're used to seeing art or the spaces that we're used to engaging with like artistic thought unavailable, artists are kind of going rogue and maybe that stuff feels more visible, but I feel like within the artist community, that's always happening. But I guess how it could be continued is definitely funding, right? So looking to funding bodies or looking to even galleries, there was some interesting conversations earlier about galleries just handing over their space to artists to maybe use as studios or using funding that maybe they would use to mount really expensive installations or exhibitions and reallocating that funding to be able to have artists within. I think the challenge is communicating the process of artistic practice, which I think we're really struggling. If you're not an artist or if you're not embedded in the arts community, it's a very difficult thing to get your head around that, you know, a water bottle sitting on a plinth can be the outcome of a year's research. Like, how do you communicate that? Or how do you communicate the value of that time that's spent considering that object? So I don't know if that helps. It's maybe just shining a lens on that a little bit more and finding ways that within our community we can try and articulate it a bit better.
Thank you. Would you like to add something, Dragan? I interrupt you a bit before.
No, thank you. Because I didn't understood you, I thought that maybe Cian asked that question. But actually, that is a question for all of us, because as Cian underlined, we are facing with a huge challenges in culture, because our museums doesn't work, our galleries are closed, the whole cultural life stopped in I suppose many countries. So the question is, what we can expect after COVID, because there's no guarantees that everything will be back in previous stage. So
maybe we don't want it to come back to the previous stage. What do you think about that?
Well, I don't know. I want to go back to previous stage. I don't want to be digitalized. But it's something that we can discuss.
Of course. No, I didn't think just about informational technology and digitalization, but some other possibility maybe to change the relations. Concerning that, I was wondering to maybe just to give one question, maybe the answer is not necessary, related to one of your map, one of your schema, Cian. In one of the last map, you present us some future projection without audience, if I understood well, where all of us are artists and involved in some kind of artistic production. So it seems to me like a kind of a society of creators, like a kind of creatocracy, if I can say like this. Do you think that maybe if the pre-assumption is that artist is not any more profession in that future projection, what would be the way to fight for that position where all of us are artists? Because now we are in the situation where all artists need to fight very very much to fight for their social rights, for their working rights, for their different level of right, economic right. And do you think that that is that could be a good way of fighting for that for this future projection that you share with us?
I think it's the option. So I guess it's that quote from the beginning that no one should be an artist until everyone can be an artist. So if there's a choice that you can choose to engage in that, and there aren't financial boundaries for you to be able to dedicate your life to being that person that is able to maintain a critical distance while imagining new futures, if that's something that everybody's able to be, I think that we would all benefit. It's not something that has to be, I guess, necessarily forced on anyone that doesn't want to, but imagine if there was a situation where it financially it was possible to imagine. And I don't think when you say that artists, if everyone's an artist, then it wouldn't be special, but I guess it would, because the sort of art that I'm talking about isn't someone that just doodles on their page. It's someone who commits themselves in a real continued lifelong journey to making work. So I think, of course, there's different quality measures that we've always relied on, but if we focus on the process, and if we focus on what it is to consciously dedicate time to remove yourself from capitalist understandings of labor and product and efficiency and value, we're all doing something really important. It doesn't matter whether the work that you make is like, it can just be that making is enough.
Okay, looking for the kleptocracy. I would like to thank you, all of you. This session was really rich at different levels. And I was wondering, now it's time for break. If you want to make a break, be free to we can formally make the end of this session. But whoever wants to stay and see a short video that Dragan wants to share with us, I would encourage you to stay. But we can decide that this is formally the end. And now we would like to see Dragan video, who wants to stay.
Okay, so it's only a few minutes, and it's a footage of Shulgin's work. I will right now share my share my screen. Okay, just to share. Oh, okay, I suppose that it's it. Yes, there is. Sorry.
Oh, I think you need some
driver. Yes.
You need some driver, or maybe you can try to open it with some other software. Because some driver for encoding you
need. Yes, there. Sorry. Okay, sorry, I had some problems. I don't know why it wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. Yes, maybe just to check. Okay, I have other player. I'll.
It's better to use other player.
Yeah, just to find again my Zoom. Okay, no. Ah, there is. Okay, now I can share my screen. Share.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Yes, and open with Velocity.
Yes, well, it's over.
Yes. Ah, there is, okay.
All the world is brown and the sky is gray. I've been for a walk on a winter's day. I've been nice and warm if I was in the way. Tell if I'm just dreaming on such a winter's day. Jump into a church, I just go on their way. Well, I got some on my knees, and I pretend to pray. You know that preacher like that car, he knows I'm gonna stay. Yeah, live on your dreaming on such a winter's day.
Thank you.
Thank you, and sorry for this technical inconvenience.
No, it was quite nice to finish in the video. Okay, see you soon. Run for the break, and we will see very soon. Ciao. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.